good to treat other people the way you would like to be treated yourself. It's like a golden rule, and there's a reason for it. And that reason is that we're connected in some strange way that we don't totally understand. And unless you are good to other people around you, unless you're kind and friendly and warm and loving, you're not going to enjoy this life. You're just not. You're going to be problems everywhere you go. You're going to have problems everywhere you go. You got to figure out a way to enjoy this life. It's not because of Jesus. It's not because of Moses. It's not because of anybody that may or may not have ever existed. It's because that's how you fit in better in the world. That's how you stay positive. And it doesn't have to be some that was written 5,000 years ago on animal skins. That doesn't have to be the golden rule because it's old. You know, that's dumb. We need to figure out, like, now, today, what is, you know, the best way to live your life? What is the, you know, there's got to be ways where you can be putting forward the most positive energy. I mean, we know objectively what's causing pollution. We know objectively what's causing birth defects and, you know, and we're taking in too much chemicals and not enough vitamins. We know objectively all this stuff. We know how to organize our world, and yet we don't do it. We know how to organize our health, and yet very few people do it. We know all these things. The right path to, like, being like a happy, healthy person is to do all the shit that we already know you're supposed to do. Take care of your body, take care of your health, take care of your mind, your stress, meditate, be kind to people. We all know that. I mean, you ask anybody, they know how to get by and to be the most evolved version of you that you can be. I mean, it's not like a magical checklist. If you talk to people about it, you said, okay, here you got a person, you want to improve them, what are the things that you're going to do to them? Okay, well, if I was a life coach, the first thing I would say is this guy's got to get on a diet that makes him healthy. I don't mean a diet just to lose weight. I mean just healthy foods in your body, many vegetables. Vegetables, a lot of good quality protein, a lot of water, stop the sodas, stop the bullshit. Start working out your body and get a better sense of, like, how this machine feels when it's moving, it's flowing better, there's less tension in it, your mind feels, like, relaxed, and you enjoy every single moment of the day better. Step one, everybody knows that step, right? What's step two? Be cool to people. Be nice to as many people as you can. Smile at as many people as you can. Have them smile back at you. Tip well when you go to restaurants. Just do the most you can. Be as nice as you can, you know, and just still manage to not have people walk all over you. Just get through this life as nice as you can. What else? Do what you want to do with your life, right? Don't be doing something you don't enjoy. Don't get locked into, you know, a car that you can't afford and doing something crazy because you need the money. Don't do that. Do what you want to do. Do what the fuck is it that you really want to do? Because if someone else is doing it, you can do it, you know? I mean, everybody makes their own path through this world, but a lot of people don't follow the path that they really feel pulled to. You know, just for whatever reason, they got negative programming. You know, when they were kids, someone told them they couldn't do it, or told them to take the shortcut, or take the sure route. That's a sad thing, man, when you talk to dudes, especially like talented dudes, and they don't follow up with what they want to do, you know? A bunch of people that will say, yeah, well, I have a family, so, you know, it's a great idea for you to just go out there and go crazy. I have people to support. You need to listen. Stop saying that. Stop saying any of those things. Every single person who has ever done anything worthwhile or exceptional or difficult or extraordinary, anyone, whether it's great artists or authors or mathematicians or whatever the it is, everyone encounters difficulties. There is no easy road. It does not exist. It is impossible. Everyone has issues. If you have time to pursue a hobby, if you have time to do anything in your life, you can better yourself. And here's one way you never better yourself. When you come up with excuses for why other people are successful and you're not, that shit is f-ing dangerous. When you give yourself an escape, yeah, well, that's easy for you to say, you know, you do this, you do this, you do this. Trust me. Everybody has a hard road. I wanted to jump out a window several times during my young life. I wanted to jump in front of a train and just end it because it's too much pressure. Not really, but you know what I'm saying. Theoretically, we all go through hard times. We all go through depression. We all go through doubt and moments in your life where it's really difficult and you're trying to figure out what the your path is going to be. It's hard as shit. But Stefan and I were talking about this before the podcast starts, that is what makes you a person. And those difficult moments are what build your character. Show me a great man who's the son of a great man. You know, that's what we're saying. These kids that are born billionaires, you're f***ed. You're f***ed. You're never going to be a self-made person. You have a backup trust for your backup trust for your trust, and you're f***ed, man. I'm fascinated by martial arts. I'm fascinated by comedy. I'm fascinated by many, many different things. I don't understand when people say they're bored. Because if I had the time to live 100 lives, I'd be speaking different languages, I'd be living in different countries, I would try a number of different careers, because I think there's a lot of unbelievably fascinating, puzzling, complex things that you could study in this world. That's just me and my personality, but that's a personality also that I've cultivated over years of challenges.
Were you like that as a kid too?
Well, I was involved in martial arts very early, and I think that is one of the things that motivated me to explore difficult tasks, because through difficult tasks you learn an incredible amount about yourself, and you through the fire of competition you get to understand motivation, you get to understand the resistance that you have inside your mind to doing hard work, you get to understand the rewards of discipline. Like, you don't truly appreciate relaxation unless you've worked hard, and that is the yin and the yang of life. And I've said this to the point of people getting sick of it, but one of the worst decisions a man can make, I can only speak for men, obviously, is to be comfortable. I don't think you should try to be comfortable. I think what you should try to do is try to earn comfort. And if you can get a day off where you've worked hard and you've accomplished goals, that day off will be so sweet. When I work hard and I sit in front of the TV, I enjoy the shit out of it. I put my feet up, I have a nice drink, you know, I enjoy my free time.
One of those chairs that nids your back or something like that?
I do have one of those.
Do you really?
Those are great.
They're great, right?
Yeah. I don't use it that much, though, honestly. I'm more of a workaholic than I should be, probably. If the balance was, I probably should relax more than I do, but I never feel like I earned it. But that's part of the reason why when I do feel like I earned it, I can enjoy it. It's because I am more connected to the idea that I need to accomplish things. And it's not like for anybody else's benefit other than my own, or anybody else's approval other than my own. I just, when I have a task, whether it's today I'm going to write 1,000 words, you know, or 2,000 or whatever the number is. If I don't do that, I write things down. Like, I'll write down a list of things that get accomplished that day. And if I don't accomplish that, I'll get sick. Like, it'll drive me crazy. If I can't fill out that list, that drives me nuts, you know? But that's what led me to be a championship level martial artist. That's what led me to achieve it's the reinforcement of those goals, like understanding that you can achieve those goals. It's going to be difficult. You're going to push through the difficulty, and then you're going to understand what difficulty truly is, and how much of it is just mental, how much of it is just in your mind, this adversity to difficult task or to struggle, you know. And a lot of people have that. They're scared of complications. They're scared of failure. Failure is a big one that people are afraid of, but failure is one of the most important things you could ever have as far as like the motivation to do things differently. One of the reasons why I think that I'm good at friendships and relationships is because I've failed at them in the past. One of the things that I'm good at comedy is because I bombed on stage. One of the reasons why I'm good at work is because I've been a shit worker in the past, and I know the feeling of failure. The feeling of shame, of being like a weak, non-motivated, lazy person. That's a weak feeling. You don't respect yourself, you know. And I have this phrase that I use all the time to people to try to motivate people. I say that be the hero in your own movie. Pretend that if your life was a movie and your life started now, what would the hero do? What would the person that you respect do? What would the person that you admire, person that inspires you, what would they do? Well, do that shit. And if you do that, you slowly build momentum. You, like, today I did what I wanted to do. Today I started a class in yoga. I did this. I did all these things that I was saying I wasn't going to do. And now I feel momentum. And momentum is a very important point in people's lives. That's why some folks don't like to take days off, because they feel like they're losing momentum. And they sort of have to restart the wheel up again after a vacation. And there's a lot of folks that live life on a cushy cloud of marshmallows and bullshit. and then one day something goes wrong. And I mean, that's why spoiled kids are so sad. Like a spoiled young boy is one of the saddest things ever. A young boy that becomes a man and can't take care of himself, and his dad has to keep on rescuing him. His dad has to keep on bailing him out of situations and giving him money. I've met guys like that, and that is a crippling affliction when they don't have the character themselves to be able to get by in life. They constantly need someone to help them and bail them out. Even as a grown man, I've met guys in their 40s that still need help from their parents. I'm like, what the f***, man? You're never going to get it right, because somewhere along the line, they didn't face enough of the adversity to realize that there's sometimes you just got to get up and get shit done. There's sometimes where you have to pull yourself up and you have to push forward, even if you want to stay in bed. And if you don't do that, and you just keep calling on your daddy, and your daddy keeps rescuing you, you never develop those tools. You never develop that ability to recognize what you're doing wrong with your life. Because you're soft, you got a cushiony, you got a safety net for your safety net.
Say if you had like a 20-year-old, and he's just a doper, where he wake and bakes and doesn't get anything done. He's just always like hanging out with his friends and playing video games, and he's just a loser. I wish there was a way you could show someone like that, like, I know that you're getting some comfort and satisfaction out of just laying around, doing nothing, eating, getting fat, but your life would feel better and richer if you had a goal, you chase that goal, you accomplish some things, you would get this boost of confidence, you'd get this boost of self-esteem, like whatever it is that you're into doing. Maybe you're into drawing comic books, maybe you're into making pottery or sculptures, or but find whatever the f*** that is and pursue that. Instead of doing nothing, like the people that are doing nothing, those are the real people. I mean, look, doing something might be as simple as like that Alex Honnold guy. He just climbs rocks, but he's world-class rock climber. It's something.
But and it's also a goal of his, and he's also the best at it, right?
Yes, yeah.
But those people who smoke pot all day and do that, those are also the guys who hate on Joe Rogan for being in shape, you know what I'm saying, or being disciplined, or get on Kevin Hart's Instagram and hate on him, you know what I'm saying? Because they don't. It's their own insecurities. I see what you're saying, but I would assume they would get motivated by seeing other people do something with their lives. Like, that should be motivating, not
discouraging. Yeah, but if you grew up with losers and you're around a bunch of people with shitty attitudes, especially if it's in your household, I was very lucky that both my mom and my stepdad, they're the least hater people I've ever met in my life. They're just not haters in any way. Like, if someone's doing well, they're always like, wow, look at this guy, or like, wow, look at her, or wow, celebrate. Look at him. There was never any hate in my house in terms of other people's success. But if you grew up with a dad and your dad's like, yeah, all these rich assholes, this he thinks she's a badass, and this, you know, these people that look at other people's success, and instead of saying, wow, that guy did a lot of work, like the way I'm a successful person, but the way I look at Kevin Hart, he exhausts me, you know, or The Rock. Those guys exhaust me. I'm like, Jesus Christ, like, I feel lazy next to those guys. Like, they do so much. Like, those guys are so overbearingly ambitious, you know. But some people, they see that and they compare themselves and they don't like it, so they can start getting really shit. And it's like a natural feeling to try to chip away at that person. The worst people that you know are the people that don't have a good self-judge, that everything they do is awesome.
Yeah.
Those never grow anywhere.
Right.
I mean, that's a huge issue with comedy. When you run into people that have terrible comedy sets but think they did great. Like, we would always, Greg Fitzsimmons and I would always talk about that with like open micers. Like, there's people that hear phantom laughs, like they think they're doing great, and they have this delusional self-opinion where everything they do is awesome, and they don't know why they're not successful already. They don't know why they're not famous. And those people, I believe, I mean, in some sort of a weird narcissistic way, you could look at it this way, that those people are there to teach you. This is the consequences of not feeling that awful feeling when you fail. I was talking to Burr a couple weeks ago. He did a set at the Comedy Store, and I saw part of it. It was, he was killing. And then I ran into him in the hallway, and I go, oh man, main room show was great, right? And he goes, yeah, I f***ed up at the end though. I tried to hang in there too long and the last bit bombed. Like, he was just, it was rotten at him that the last bit, like, he goes, I f***ing hung in there too long. I should have got off with a bit before that.
Yeah.
And like, but you know, when I was in there, he was f***ing killing, yeah. You know, but that wasn't in his mind. The success was not in his mind. This, the, what was like, okay,
whatever that happened at the end, don't do that again.
Right.
You know?
Right.
But that's why he's Bill Burr. That's why he's really good. You're alone with your thoughts. You get an idea of what your thoughts actually are. If you live your life just acting constantly on the momentum of other people's expectations, of you wanting to be liked by these other people, you can run into a trap, and you set up a life that you didn't really want. You're trapped in this situation where you have a mortgage, you've got credit card bills, you got student loans you have to pay, you have a bunch of shit going on that you have to continue to feed. And all that, and especially if you have a family and you have to feed them, oh my goodness. Then you're fully locked in. You can't take any chances whatsoever. And oftentimes people make the mistake of getting stuck. And it is just a tactical mistake, just like it would be a mistake if you got stuck on a video game. Just like it would be a mistake if you followed a map incorrectly and you get stuck in the woods. Your life is certainly some sort of a journey. It's certainly some sort of a journey. And we have to all be aware that when we're making journeys, we're not going to always make the right steps. And sometimes you have to back up and try again. And if you're in a position where you can't back up and try again, you've trapped yourself. And the system will set out honeypots for people to get trapped in. The system will set out the ideas of retirement, the ideas of the golden years, providing you benefits, providing you a healthy work environment. Why? Well, because they want people to work for them. They don't want people to realize their own dreams and escape. But that's a pain in the ass. So you got to hire more people and train them. And they want to set it up so that you stick around. You stick around in some sort of an unsatisfying world. It's up to you to see that video game problem, to see that issue as it comes up on the map. No, I think this is a right turn. To see all the problems that could potentially lay in front of you and calculate your future, and then also look around all the people that didn't do it and look at the misery that they're in and learn that you don't want to be like them, and then look at the people that have kind of taken chances and navigated their way. What did they do differently than you? What objectivity do they have that maybe you lack? What insight into their own mistakes are they willing to delve into that you're not, that you step back and you go, I just don't want to look at myself that closely. But the person who's able to look at themselves the closest is going to get the more rational results. One of the things that's causing this funk that people are in is that we're living our lives, many of us at least, in these very unfulfilling ways, where you're going to this office with artificial light and you're doing something you don't want to do all day long, and then you get home and you're tired. And on top of that, you're eating shit. You're eating potato chips and you're drinking soda, and your body is just like, what in the f*** is this? We're supposed to be out in the fields. We're supposed to be walking up hills. We're supposed to be looking for animals or gathering vegetables. We're supposed to be doing all these things that our body's designed to do. We're supposed to be in nature.
Yeah.
And nature is like a medicine. Like, it literally is a medicine to you. Like, okay. People that go, you don't have to go hunting. You don't have to go fishing. Just go hike, man. Just go hike up to the top of a mountain and look out. You know, there's a reward that you get from that is intensely, like, soul-filling. Mm-hmm. There's, like, something about, like, when I was in Colorado, and there was this this area of Boulder where you drive up one of these roads, and there was this area where you could park, and it was this incredible view, man. And these people just park and just go out there and just look. But you get there and you park and you go, because you would see, you're literally seeing the Continental Divide. These snow-capped mountains in July.
Yeah.
In July, it's covered with snow. For whatever reason, most people, their associations are to avoid anything that's uncomfortable. But it's so illogical, because when you look at comfort and you look at success and progress and the feelings of accomplishment and of getting past certain hurdles in terms of, like, how you feel about life, a lot of those are connected to discomfort. Like, discomfort is your friend. It really is. Like, discomfort and not being happy and content with certain situations in life or certain feelings in life, they're massive, massive motivators, and they're amazing at facilitating change. And yet our instinct is to avoid those and just sit on the couch and watch some reality show about dudes who make moonshine with our jaw open, like, ooh. It's bizarre.